Well, first of all, Day of the Dead is really been a resurrection, I think, of our community coming together as a community. And Selfographics has been the center for this. Day of the Dead is celebrated all over. Even wherever there's Mexicans throughout the United States, there's Day of the Dead. Here in Los Angeles, you know, it takes on different life depending where it is and where it's held and who does it. But I think the consistency of Selfographics, hopefully that tradition stays. You know, they still emphasize they'd like to have it authentic as far as that it honors our dead and that it celebrates life. And that's where I continue doing it there. And I always wait to be asked. I don't assume that I've just because I've been there so long. I wait for someone to say, yes, are you going to do the altar? Will you do? And so that's an honor for me, for them to want me to do that. And of course, now I include my children, Rosanna. In fact, this year we got a grant from the ACTA as a master, master artist apprentice. 10 years ago, it was with Elena. And so she's doing her altars, and Rosanna will continue it. And that's one of the things that I feel very comfortable about, that my children will, I want them to continue this. Well, for me, personally, it was that my children and my grandchildren would follow this, because it was my mother's tradition. And those kinds of things were my mother's, what drove her in her life to remember, especially to remember, our ancestors, her mother. It was like as if I knew my great-great-grandmother who raised her, like as if I knew her personally, but I thought I had never met her, but I found my son found a negative that he developed, and she's holding me, and I'm about 3 months old. And it was the most wonderful experience for me too, because I always felt connected to her. She was the matriarch, and my mother always talked about her. And called her my mama Pola. It was actually her great-great aunt, because she took over the raising of her sister's child, then her niece, and then my mother. They were three generations, and because she didn't have children, she was a widow, had married. So she was always the one who took over the raising of it was always a girl that was left for whatever, all these different reasons behind with her. So my mother was, and then so she still helped my mother with my brother. My mother had him in Chicago and then moved to Los Angeles where her father was. And so she still helped my mother with me until she went back to Mexico. And she went back to Mexico during the what did we call it? Not deportations.
Repatriations.
And she wasn't repatriated, but because she had come from Chicago, she probably wasn't in the books. But so many of our neighbors and even paisanos from her town, so she said, I'm going to go back with you. I don't want to. So she said in Spanish, no quiero morirme en esta tierra bárbara. I don't want to die in this barbarous country. And so she went back to my mother's hometown, Guanimaro. And I always thought she had died. I was born in 1932. She went back probably 1933 or 4, whenever these repatriations, or 34. And I thought she had died soon then. But when I went to Mexico to look up her records, I found her death certificate. She died in 1938. So she was already a very elderly lady, and anyway, that's another story. The stories about her abound, and she's my hero, besides my mother and she, because they were single women. My mother married, but for all the in-between times, she was the woman. She was la mera mera, like the main woman, and resourceful, and because she had been raised by Mama Pola, who was very strong, and just they knew by their own talents, paper, decorations, cooking, especially the cooking, making, my mother could make dresses out of yardage and help sell them or exchange them for something. I mean, she was really, we were on welfare because my father got TB when she met him in Chicago, but here he was diagnosed with TB when I was 6 years old. My youngest sister was just a year, less than a year, and she was the only one who had contacted TB and my father. He would, those days they would send them to sanitariums for years, and so he was there many years, and then my mother divorced him and later married my stepdad, who was the most wonderful, just the perfect balance for my mother, because my mother was tough and independent, and he was patient and sweet and hardworking, because she was, she ran things.
And she had to be tough.
She had to be tough. And so he was just complimented her. And so he was to my youngest sister. I always remembered my dad because, but my youngest sisters only remember my stepdad. My sister was too young to remember my dad.
Do you know where they sent your dad? What sanitarium?
Yeah, he went to Olive View Sanitarium. He was there, I don't know how many years. I've tried to investigate it. I haven't done deep investigation. But then he died in 1956. I looked for that, and I guess it doesn't exist anymore. I don't know what it's probably the Harbor General Hospital. It was in Long Beach. It was a county hospital, and he died there. Later years, he had a lung removed when he was in Olive View, and his death certificate said he died of complications of diabetes. I never knew he had diabetes, but he had always had only one lung, and he had been a smoker too. So he died of different reasons, and it was sad because I didn't get to know him as well as, but I always remembered the time that I was with him, because he taught me to read. He used to be a classical flutist, and he came from León, Guanajuato, and one of the tours, they came to Topeka, Kansas, and then he either stayed or came back. I'm not sure of that story, but my mother would tell me, and when he came to Los Angeles to find him, and then I think he already had or susceptible to open to TB because his wife died of TB, his first wife. He was 16 years older than my mother. And he would come home covered in the dust. And so all the compadres who worked with him, they were paisanos from their town, my mother's town. They all had TB. So William was saying that it was probably his investigation of an asbestos plant or something that. And so he, when I was born in it, it was it wasn't the tail end of the Depression. I guess it was by 1933 or 4. And so my mother says he sold his silver flute for $50 to buy me milk. And, for me. And I felt so sad about that he gave up, his. But he always listened to classical music and always on the radio and reading the paper. So that's how I learned to read. He would read the paper and then I would say, "What does that say?" And he would read it in Spanish, in English. And then I started catching on the word "the." There it is, "the." And then I started to put things together, and he would guide me. So I learned to read. By the time I was in kindergarten, what I thought it was. I never thought of it before until I was well into school. Well, that's right. I was really young.
Why did your mom go to Chicago?
Because that's where her mother was. Well, that story I always have to tell because it talks about why my mother was so marvelous. She was left behind by her mother, and I don't know, when I would ask more detailed questions, my mother either didn't know or she would say, "Ya me cansé, no me acuerdo," she just wouldn't go into that. But she remembers her early memories were not of her mother, it was of her dad in 19... see, she was born in 1904. She was about 6 years old. She was 1910 during the revolution, where the federal troops came, would go into the small villages to take the young men. They call it La Cinta, Encinta, I think they called it. Well, it's forced draft. And so they came into her village and they took all these young men. And my mother remembers that Mama Pola said, told somebody, come, go and call Guadalupe because they're taking her dad. And she was 6 years old. And so she ran over there and he had asked the priest to bless him. And so that's the last she remembers seeing her dad, seeing him, you know, taken away. And she never saw him again until she came to Los Angeles. Because then the war, I don't know where he went, and then he eventually, but my grandmother wasn't in the picture then. She had left earlier with her brother. And my mother would say she had a brother, someone living in New Mexico, but she didn't. And then later she moved, my grandmother moved to Chicago and she married there. And so my mother, she did write to my mother, and my mother says, but she would send me sometimes money or shoes. And so I was the only one with shoes from the United States because most of them were barefoot. Mm-hmm. She must have been very young then because she left Guanimaro with Mama Pola. They left at night because what they would do, you know, the Federals and the revolutionaries, they'd come into the towns for food, to grain, and they had granaries. And so at night somebody would alert that they, IBNN, whoever it was, and then they would hide all the young girls because they would take the young girls with them. You know, that was
the way of war.
That's the way of war. And so they would hide. My mother was, by then, she was maybe close to 11 or 12, but, you know, so they would hide in these granaries, and one night Mama Pola told her, we're going to leave tonight. So, you know, they gathered just what they, in a mochila and some kind of blanket or something. And she says they left at night when the moon was really bright and without shoes. And she said she got stuck with a thorn someplace, and they walked at night. And they made their way to Irapuato, which is in the, it's halfway from... And she had, Mama Pola had worked as housekeeper for a hacienda, and they went there and they said, oh yes, you could be here. And it, I don't know how long they were there. It sounds like she, by the time my mother got to Juarez, what my mother says they would do is that they would cook and sell the food to workers, farm workers, along the way. And so she always, they always had a way to eat, and it was through her cooking and through her skills. So my mother helped her all the time.
What is the favorite meal your mom made?
Oh gosh, nopalitos, I guess. She made them in all kinds of ways. And the delicacy, she would ask me, what do you want me to cook for your birthday? What's it? Tacos de sesos. I loved them because I've never eaten them again like hers. It's a very high standard that I put. Many, many platillos that are traditional, but it was just our everyday food. And so my mother made their way, they were in Irap. I'm not sure exactly, my mother didn't designate, but because she says they would travel and then stay a while. So my mother was a teenager by the time that one day she told my mother, because my mother was growing, she had a watcher, you know, and all these, and she says, you know, I'm getting too old to take care of you. Write to your mother and tell her that I died. She'll have to come for you. For us, she'll say. So my mother did that. She said, my grandma has died. So her mother wrote back, and they says, they must have been near Juarez. Anyway, they met to meet at the depot, and my mother said she had a picture of her mother with a hat on. And she said, you know, I'll be wearing a big hat and we'll meet there in the train station in Juarez. So she says they were there all day long, and my mother would see, she couldn't see anybody that looked like that, and they were sitting there and they would move from place to place. And so she said, but there was a woman who they had seen there, but it wasn't her mother, you know. So then Mama would just go ask that lady, maybe she's seen her mother, take the picture and show her. And so my mother went to Esther and said, oh, no, that Esther Consuelo me mandó. She sent me because she was having a baby or something. So they got on the, she had sent passage in the, on the train to Chicago, and that's where my mother went. And her mother was a character, too. She adored her parents like nothing because she didn't grow up with them, and so they were like treasures to her. She already had a family. I think she had 3 children, had just had my aunt, who's 92 right now. My grandmother had a boarding house and had 15 boarders. So, and besides, she had a young child. So she says, my mother says, we got there at Mama Pola and I. My Mama Pola took care of the kids, and I helped my mother the cooking, the cleaning. So she worked. She always worked. And my mother met her husband, my brother's dad, there. And my mother's story is, I mean, it's an odyssey to a saga. His name was Rodolfo Estrada. And they got married. My mother had my brother in 1926. And my mother, the details, nomás de 27 días de nacido, nos fuimos a México. They went to Nochistlan, where he was from, and learned that he had a fictitious name. He had changed his name. And Billy has looked into, my brother says that he asked his dad why he had changed his name. He had been in prison or had gone into some trouble, and so he just took somebody else's name. And so my mother was stubborn. She didn't change his name. So his name should have been Arcadio Iñiguez, but it's Rodolfo Estrada. And all his half-brothers are Iñiguez, and that created kind of a problem when he died. They said, well, we're the true
heirs.
Or my brother only wanted a gun that his dad had promised him, but anyway, that's another
People
story.
People are horrible at that.
But that's so my mother, but in Mexico, she was there 3 years with my brother. Her husband came back to Chicago because he had a job at the Sherwin-Williams Company, where the railroad and the Sherwin-Williams Company were the places where the immigrants, big Mexican community there. But then she got word that her mother had said that, you better come home because he has another woman. And her mother, she heard the story, had threatened to shoot him if she didn't go for her daughter. And she went up there because she carried a .45. They called her La Tejana. And went up there, and he got out of the two-story place with tied sheets to get away from her. And so he went back and got her. Her mother died, unfortunately, in 1930, right soon. My mother came back in 1920, at the end of 1928, and her mother had died in childbirth. So she died of pneumonia at Christmas time, now that I remember. And I haven't found any records, but I'm still digging. And my aunt has all these stories because she was 5 years old when her mother died. And my mother came to California, so she had a hard time.
Mm. Well, I know you were born in 1932, so repatriation's 33. You're going to have no memory of it.
But do you... stories. I experienced that during World War II with the detention of Japanese, because it affected people we knew. And I had a friend in school who was sent to the camps with her family, of course. And we had it was wonderful in those days. The cleaners would come, a Japanese man from the cleaners, but he had his shop on First Street. It was called the OK Cleaners. And he struck up a romance with one of my mother's friends who he met at our house. She was a widower. I don't know if she was ever married, and I never pictured her as someone married, you know, because she never was, and she never was with any history that I knew of. But I don't know if they met and they got married. And when they were taken, she was pregnant. Now, she was a Mexican national, so she could not go with him. I didn't know why, but I asked my mother, why can't she go with him? She would cry and cry, and she had a nervous breakdown. She lost her child, and I don't know what happened to her afterwards. It was so sad, and she would cry so much. Here she found the love of her life, and then he was taken away, and she couldn't go with him. Maria se llamaba. I don't remember her last name, and then she, I think she went back to Mexico. I just didn't see her again, but she used to come to our house because she had met him there. Just on, you know, when he come, but he would be, they would talk and then joke. My mother was, you know, really an outgoing person, and he was just open to platicar with us. And then when he met her, he came back a lot often. And then they developed their own relationship, my mother was just so happy that she got married, because she was, you know, I guess because she hadn't been married and she was alone, and she was so happy. What I do recall is all on First Street where Little Tokyo is, all the merchants had all their merchandise out on sale, you know, and my mother went out there because we bought dishes. All these pretty Japanese dishes, and so they were all, you know, selling things at almost nothing. And so we went down there a couple of times. The only contact I had was with that girl who was in Pearl was her name. I thought she was Chinese because there was a Chinese family who lived across the street from school, the Hamill Street School. And I didn't know, you know, but when she left, I didn't know she had left, and we wondered what had happened, and the teacher told us that she and her family had to leave to a camp, you know, because I would ask why, and he says, it's because they had to. It was just not discussed. I just learned about it, you know, as later, and then from just the news that I would hear. You know, there wasn't like this massive, not it here anyway. I saw it in the news downtown where people gathered and from the newsreel. But I remember a few people passing by blowing horns, but it wasn't a big demonstration here that I experienced, only from the news. I was coming out of school, Belvedere School, 1941. I was 9 years old. No, I wasn't coming. I was passing by Belvedere, and somebody, you know, I think it was kids from the school. They were talking. I was coming from Salas, the corner, and they were just buzzing. And I said, "What's the matter?" And I didn't ask them, but I just was listening and say. And they were talking about, you know, a war bombing. Now, I had really been affected by the war. In a way, it kind of started when my father used to listen to the radio about Germany, you know, the Poland. And then he went away in 1938. But by 1941, you know, I was, you know, hearing the news. We had radios, of course, then. And it just was so, I really didn't understand. I did go to the movies a lot, though, so it was, they'd show clips, you know, like a newsreel. It was short clips in between film. And so I did see bombing, but in Europe. And I used to, I would wake up with nightmares because I had seen photographs of bombings and people digging out, and I say, oh my gosh, I would have nightmares that I was in one of those, and that I would pretend that I was dead, so that they wouldn't, you know, run over me. And then I would say, but then they come walking, and I would wake up like it was really traumatized by the film I had seen on afraid of bombings and war. So when I heard that, I couldn't relate to it in a way because I was terrified of thinking of the people who were down below, wherever they were. And how do you get away from that, you know? So I would think of ways you could hide, you know, as a kid. How do you hide from things like that? So my thing was pretending you're dead, but then under what, you know? I would think about that quite a bit. And then in 1942, my uncle, he lived in Chicago. He came to visit my mother. He was in the army, and he stayed with us for a few days before he was being shipped to the Pacific. And that's when I first met my uncle. He was so handsome, and my mother hadn't seen him since she had left Chicago in 1930 maybe. And so it was a wonderful reunion for them. And her other brother was in the Navy. I didn't meet him until many years later in 1950s. But he had joined the I tried to look for that, but I haven't looked deeply. He was in the CCC camps. Some of his records say he's from Los Angeles, but he was born in Mexico, but all his life was in Los Angeles. But since he was older than the rest of his, you know, brothers and sisters, I know he was in the CC camp, so he was enlisted in the 1930s census with the rest of them. And so some of his records call his place of birth Los Angeles. So my mother hadn't seen him, so I think he was in those camps somewhere here before he joined the service. But he joined the service in Chicago. I found those records. And he went to the Pacific, and he used to write to my mother, and he was a prolific writer, and he was an artist. After the war, he had malaria. He was disabled the rest of his life. He did work, but it just never left him. And he would call it was a green hell, and he had drawings and writings of his, like a diary that he showed me. And so I was forever against war. I have been a pacifist all my life, I guess. Then my brother went to, in 1944, he went to the service. He was 18. And in 1945, he was wounded, and he went to Germany. He was wounded, and he came home right about before the war ended, but he had already been out. And then in Vietnam, my youngest brother went to, right after graduation, he joined the Marines. I was totally against it. I was 17 years older than he was. And he was there 2 years, almost at the end of his stay, and he was wounded severely. He had in the head. So we visited him, and he was in the Navy hospital in San Diego. And it's the worst image of war. It was horrible. That whole section was on head injuries. You saw young men that were, it was horrible. And then my brother had a section off his skull, so he had a big dent. He later had a steel plate put on. He was not paraplegic, but he was paralyzed on one side, and he was able to walk to a certain degree. And so that affected us. I mean, it's, and my, it's interesting, my brother, Billy's dad, when he was a young kid, well, East LA, all these, this was the main street, but beyond that, where all the memory was all open fields, and there were, in fact, part of it was of Japanese flower farms, and even part of where East LA College, those were fields of flowers, really pretty.
So it's called Floral.
Yes, oh. Floral Drive, and he used to go hunt up there. Well, he always worked, so he made money to buy himself a BB gun that he sent for a Red Ryder or something, and so they'd go hunting up in these hills, and so he always was a gun enthusiast. So we disagree on that part. But he has never left the service, because when he came back from the service, he had been wounded in 1945. In 1946, his girlfriend, they got married, and In 1950, he was sent to Korea because he was in the National Guard. It was just what everybody did, you know, a veteran to get their benefits. And they used to just go march, you know, like twice a month or something. Well, he was drafted into the Korean War, and he already had his child, and almost all the people, and he was a sergeant, were young kids, and he said it was the most horrible experience. They were inexperienced, and they hadn't been trained for war. You know, they had been, a National Guard was more like marching. But, you know, he was, I guess because all these traumatic parts of his life, that was a big part of his life, just have stayed with him. He belongs to these veterans group. He goes to a lot of funerals, and he always, the conversation goes back to me. I remember this guy. He was from here, and he got killed, or he did this or that. And it's just forever. I mean, here it was 1960s. And I had been going back to school, as I told you, but not full-time yet. And I just stayed and listened to all these speakers, and passionate, and it was exciting because, I mean, I was in my 40s, I had my 9 children already, and, you know, it just was a new experience for me to be amid, you know, all this energy and all these, and I think I just became so conscious of political activity, all that, all in a very short time, from 1968 to the present, but all packed into, you know, after the moratorium, I continued with marching and protests with the Nicaraguan conflict and El Salvador. Going to East LA College was my education, and it just felt wonderful to be able to say something, to be part of this energy and this, these voices. It was finding my voice. It was devastating. 1968, I had all my children already. Yeah, I had my 9 children, and it was, I guess it started with Kennedy. No, it started before that. I was working at a bank a short time before I had Rosanna, 1961. But the civil rights movement was happening, and I worked in a vault, you know, doing, it was part of, it would be an open vault, but there were all these files. I was a file clerk, and I was new there. I had only been there a month when they moved me to that department, and the woman that was sitting, that was a veteran. She was an older woman. She had been there for like 18 years. She was the most racist person I had ever experienced, because I don't know why, but she started talking about all those niggers, you know, they're causing so many problems. And I had already had some experience with them at school, because I was not against me, but the feeling of mostly immigrants, I guess. And the news had come on of those 4 little girls that were killed in a bombing. And as I recall, it was I imagined it as an intersection. I don't know why I think of that. And then I said, how could you say that? You know, 4 children were killed. She's saying that all these people were rabble rousers and they're causing all these problems. And I said, it's the other way around, isn't it? They just killed 4 children. Well, that's terrible. But she would, and then another, then she said, you know, but do you know that I don't think it was, she said colored people, that their milk is black. And I said, that's ridiculous. Everyone's milk is dark at the beginning. I've had 9 children. And she was so racist. And then afterwards I said, I'm just not going to talk to her. And then one day, I wouldn't answer. She would ever come. She just wanted to make conversation, but it was always something, you know, that I. And so she said, oh, you're not talking to me? And got it. you know, I just ignored her. And she would mumble and say, because she it made her angry that here I was this little...
And she knew you were right. She knew you were right.
So she stopped talking to me, and I would pass her, and I wouldn't even talk to her. I didn't tell her things, but I just wasn't going to be part of her conversation. So she actually, she was close to retirement. I didn't see her again. I don't know what happened to her, but I was happy. But anyway, those were kinds of...
that kind of violence.
Yes, it was horrible. The violence was beyond my imagination. I became more interested in watching. In fact, I did a drawing from television. It was a scene, and I've seen that scene similar to that where they're hosing down protesters, the police or the fire department, with, you know, full blast on a person. You know, can you imagine how much it
on
hurt?
Kids.
And then there's this man who has this look. It just kind of, and it just stayed with me. I did a drawing of him. I tried to anyway, but it was that look of terror. I have it in my sketchbook. And I used to stay up late watching, because I would do my homework late. And so I saw a lot of the newsreel. My mother was very, for not having that mobility, by 1968 she was in a wheelchair. But still continued coming to the seniors group. They pick her up, and she was always talking about the things that were happening. And she just loved Polanco, Richard Polanco. He was a young, charismatic politician. But he'd go into this is before he got elected into Congress or the Senate. He would go to the seniors I'm not sure, I guess they just talks or, but she admired him. Roybal, she did canvas work for him, and she was very politically minded. And you know, my mother was an elder, the whole housewife. Her contacts were the seniors, and she would say, oh, she would get so upset. Old people are so close-minded, and they're so, she would complain. All they think about is dancing and trying to make out at their old age. I said, really? Them? Why do we need these classes for? We're getting old. But you have to know. You have to know what's happening. There's so many things that you have to be aware of that are not right, you know, she would say.
Yeah.
So she was a great inspiration, and always... You know, so she didn't know deeper into, but she was aware of things. And so I was really proud of her, because by that time I was had become more politically aware. And I would talk to her about the things, and she'd say, if I could go, I would go with you. I would go and march with you and yell at you. And I said, well, I don't necessarily yell, but I'm there and I'm, you know... And so she was very active. And so even after we all were, because she had a picture. It was interesting how many homes. She had a picture of Kennedy and then one of them two together. But she had one of Kennedy. I still have it. I used it in one of the altars because it was reflecting my mother. And then she had Our Lady of Guadalupe next to her. Those two are always there, Kennedy and Our Lady of Guadalupe.
And but then, Bobby Kennedy.
Then,
JFK. John, okay.
But then with Bobby Kennedy, he came to East LA. He came to, and that was a big event. And my mother was a very staunch supporter of him too. I was too. You know, I didn't analyze this as much. I thought that maybe not only because of, you know, his ethic was seemed to be with working people, and that was, and also being Catholic. And that was another connection with him. And he was truly a supporter. I've heard Dolores Huerta and Christine, Cesar's granddaughter, talk about that period, how he helped them in certain many ways.
He legitimated them.
And also getting permits and getting, mm-hmm. you know, his power helped them open doors with certain areas, especially with the growers, you know, how his clout, he had clout that added to their being able to be places or things like that. They weren't overtly announced, but that he said he opened doors to them. In their conversation, I was listening to them. So I truly believe, I don't know, I sometimes I'm criticized saying, oh, you believe it, anything. But I truly believe that he was very interested in us. And not only that, he was interested in working people and poor people and injustice.